Hello and welcome to Healthy Seminars. I'm your host, your moderator, Lauren Brown. I'm a doctor of traditional Chinese medicine. My practice is in Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada at AcuBalance Wellness Center, acubalance.ca. As your moderator today, during the live webinar, if you have any questions or comments, please post them in the chat room. And during the live webinar, I will capture those and moderate those to Lew Lim during the talk and also during the question and answer. Handouts from this lecture are inside your account. So if you register for this course, you're here watching as a recording or as a live webinar. Inside your account is also the handouts for this lecture. I'd like to just remind you that this is for educational purposes only. This is not meant to be medical advice. If you have a health concern, if you have a health condition, please seek out a medical practitioner. Again, this is for continuing education purposes only and is not meant to be and is not medical advice. Now, let me just introduce this. I'm quite excited about this because I've been playing around and now quite seriously working with, it was once termed cold laser, then low-level light therapy, LLLT, and now it seems like we may be settling on with the terminology photobiomodulation. But for those that are new to this terminology, you might have heard it as cold laser or low-level laser therapy. So our talk today with Dr. Lew Lim is on photobiomodulation and laser therapy, energy medicine. Energy medicine involves energy fields in some form that helps the body to restore health. Acupuncture is one of the most popular forms of energy medicine that has a 2,500-year tradition involving the balancing of the energy chi. The use of light as a medicinal or as a medical intervention has entered into the field of energy medicine from the blind side that can only happen with the advent of modern science. The term for this modality is photobiomodulation, PBM, as I mentioned, also low-level light therapy or cold laser. It's relatively new at the time of this recording, but it has thousands of sets of research evidence and has been presented since the 1960s with photobiomodulation, commonly known as low-level laser therapy. It involves the delivery of light energy to modulate cellular mechanisms that often result in better health. Because light is a most fundamental energy particle that is the source of life on Earth, it could hold profound potential to influence health. More people are discovering this, and today, photobiomodulation is widely used for pain management, hair growth, skin treatment, fat loss, esthetics, wound healing, and a variety of brain conditions. Here at AcuBalance in Vancouver, we use it for pain, for skin, part of the whole facial rejuvenation, and for fertility. We've been pioneering using laser therapy for fertility. And the reason I invited Dr. Lew Lim to speak is when I was doing some research on low-level light therapy, I fell down that rabbit hole and I started learning about it for brain injury and Alzheimer's. And it was his system and his research that he's involved in that came up. And so I said, I want to know about this because I have patients whose parents have been diagnosed with dementia and Alzheimer's, and I'm quite curious how we can do to support them in such a non-invasive and no side effect modality. And so he was so nice to accept my offer, and here he is today lecturing. Lew Lim will show us how it is even possible to use low-level light therapy to treat some of the most challenging brain insults and even enhance the state of human brains that are already healthy. Photobiomodulation could be the energy medicine for the future, and I have started, Lew, putting this on my head a couple times a week. I call it my brain boost, right, just to keep me sharp, because my friends who know me, I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer, so I need all the help I could get. So I often started using this, and I call it the brain boost. Dr. Lew Lim is growing in his reputation as a leader in translating photobiomodulation science into practical applications. His research on using PBM, photobiomodulation, LLT, for brain function is at the cutting edge. His collaborative research involves research at the University of Toronto, Harvard Medical School, Boston University, and University of California and San Francisco, amongst others. His collaborative research team is the first to show positive early evidence of improvement in dementia with photobiomodulation. He is a doctor of natural medicine, a neuroscientist, and an engineer with further degrees in accountancy and business administration. His alma mater includes the University of California, Berkeley, and the University of Sheffield and Quantum University. So again, if you have questions during this live webinar, post them in the chat room. I will moderate them. Also, Lew Lim is one of the founders and CEOs of V-Light, where they sell the laser device that you can use on the head and in the nose, which he's going to talk about, for dementia and Alzheimer's. And I always said, hey, you're going to be on my platform. Do you have any deals for people watching? And they offered a 10% discount. So the coupon code for you watching this, if you decide to get one of these devices, is Vancouver, because that's where I live. That's where my clinic is, and that's where I live. So, and that's where Healthy Seminars headquarter is. So coupon code is Vancouver if you're looking for a discount on his website, which is vielight.com. All right, Lew, please take it away. Let's hear what you have to say.
Well, Lon, thank you for the introduction. It appears that you are actually pretty knowledgeable about photobiomodulation. That takes saves me some time. I was going to spend some time introducing it. So as you can see from my next slide, I was going to say what photobiomodulation is. At the bottom is, so for a long time it's been known as low-level light therapy. And along with the light, to pull out the first video to show how light affects single cells. Right, this is this is an example. There are a few of these videos showing that, cells have a natural affinity to light. So that's where I like to start. And the mitochondria is a bacteria, is a form of a cell. So can you remove the video now? Right, Lon has explained the various applications of photobiomodulation. I don't want to spend any time on it. Just want to tell you that it's been used, as Lon has mentioned, for hair growth, for aesthetics, for pain reduction, and in serious research too. And this is somewhat dramatic, but it demonstrates the healing power of photobiomodulation. This was a diabetic wound, and over 20 sessions of applying low level laser, you can see it wasn't controlled, but there were there's quite a number of case studies like this. So it obviously affects what's happening in soft tissues. Here's an example of a form of photobiomodulation called photodynamic therapy. It's been approved, I think, by FDA for cancer treatment, especially skin cancer. Here's an example of cancer in the lip, where you direct a red light to activate a photosensitizer, and you activate these free radicals to destroy cancer cells. And so we are here talking about energy medicine. I think many of you are seeing this, in traditional medicine, when you talk about energy medicine, you cover, say, acupuncture, Ayurvedic medicine, the chakras, talking about Reiki. So here's one form of understanding energy medicine over the centuries, but it's taking a new twist with a modern twist with photobiomodulation, because we're using a photon. The photon is if you understand physics, quantum physics, particle physics, is powerful. It is, there's no mass, it's pure energy. It takes on quantum properties to be in multiple positions. So today's research in, say, photosynthesis recognizes the importance of quantum mechanics in how the photon is being harnessed for energy. But that's really, really interesting. And now we can explain energy this way, by way of physics, chemistry, and biology. And the foundation of this is really what it does to the mitochondria. The mitochondria exists in virtually all cells in the body, except, the red blood cells. But it is really, the fact that I'm talking to you is the, the activation of mitochondria producing all the required energy. So it is fundamental to our existence. Now, when you direct red and infrared light to the mitochondria, which is represented here, and here the mitochondria, what happens is it produces ATP. ATP is not just the energy molecule for your body. For our purposes, particularly, it represents a signaling molecule. And ROS is reactive oxygen species, which is low level free radical. At that level, it activates all the various proteins that lead to gene transcription. But the other thing it does is it releases nitric oxide back into the body, which explains a lot about why photobiomodulation improves blood circulation, oxygenation throughout the body. It is a very important molecule. And so we lead to gene transcription, which lead to, at cellular level, the growth factor production, cell proliferation, cell motility, which is the ability to move around better. Matrix deposition is improving the integrity and the structure of the cells. And that leads to what you've seen in that other picture: wound healing, tissue repair, tissue death prevention, reduction of inflammation, get pain relief, through perhaps the release of endorphin or blocking of the pain signals, reducing swelling and edema, acute injury, chronic diseases, reduces pain, as I mentioned, neurological problems, and actually enhances the practice of acupuncture. Now, the importance of the mitochondria is actually getting more recognized. The studies on the activity of mitochondria and how it affects various diseases is growing really rapidly. Now, this is a good representation of how we understand the mitochondria now. Here, the center of it all is oxidative phosphorylation, which releases ATP. But it affects a bunch of other things, which some of it I mentioned before. At the in this middle triangle here, when you talk about more systemic physiological functions, you're affecting the central nervous system, the immune and system, and inflammation, the neuroendocrine, metabolic, and cardiovascular. Then here's what we're really interested in, the clinical outcomes. And so when we practice medicine, energy medicine, various methods, what we're trying to achieve is all these things really, clinical outcomes, other than enhancement of our functions. We're talking about preventing cognitive decline. There's evidence, pretty clear, about diabetes, functional limitation. These are other things to do with aging, mortality, to avoid premature aging and cardiovascular functions. So the interesting thing about photobiomodulation is it is systemic. You apply in one area, it affects other parts of the body. So people who have done practice, even people doing cancer research, have told me, look, I did apply to a cancer tumor in one place, it seems to be affecting another place of the body. So not a lot of published, but this is what people observed. And but this is based on some published papers. This was a review done by the folks at the University of Sydney, showing that, to address damaged neurons, when you apply direct, you actually affect the mitochondria and therefore stimulate recovery. And you can even apply somewhere in animal study the femur or the tibia in the leg, and it is affecting what's happening in the brain. And they explain it. I want you to know this, because I'm going to touch on this again: circulating factors, which is you know, a lot of stuff, you know, a lot of hypotheses, but it involves some elements that seems to affect the body systemically. So when we talk about this, we really, you know, collectively, the cells do not necessarily respond to photobiomodulation when it is balanced, it is at its optimal state, homeostasis. So you might explain it, you know, collectively, it's a balancing of the yin and yang, you know, the chi flow, the balancing of the chakras and so on. And so this is a nice illustration by a Chinese professor from China who is a leader in this field. And he said, what he's saying is when you, the cells are in homeostasis here, so, but as they go further away from homeostasis, the activity level increases. So as the cells are away from homeostasis, and he says it's functional homeostasis, the response is greater. And this is an important factor to note. And so to put it very simply, you know, diseases upsets homeostasis, or out of homeostasis creating diseases, and you're out of balance. So an example is, you know, the oxidants are, and these other factors are, you know, weighing more than the antioxidants. But when you're in homeostasis, so everything is balanced, it, you know, it then affects your immune system, your circulatory system, your central nervous system, the brain, and so on. So we are trying to achieve this balance in the systems of the body, and one way to do it is, you know, affecting the mitochondria through photobiomodulation. When it affects the body, there's some studies as mentioned before, and it actually affects the brain indirectly, rehabilitating the brain. So how do you introduce this red and near infrared light to get this wonderful effect? And the Russians actually got into this. Lon explained that, you know, photobiomodulation was discovered, published in the 1960s. In the 80s, the Russian published papers that, you know, if we introduce light into the body, low-level laser, by injecting it into the vein, you can get really some interesting results. And so a lot of the literature, actually, most of the literature was not in English. They were mainly in Russian, because the Russians and the, you know, the Eastern European bloc at the time were dominating in the research in photobiomodulation. So this was a review done, published in the British, by British scientists. And I thought this was a bit of a landmark, actually, because most people were ignoring it. I was quite interested that they actually published it. And so they said, you know, you should really look into this, because when you inject, they call it these intravenous blood irradiation, you know, injecting red and near infrared light into the body, you're getting all these wonderful results. They're all published. The citations are actually, you know, mainly published, papers published in Russian. So you get cellular metabolic activation, increased functional activity. You have, you know, stimulation of repair as a result of increased cell proliferation. There's anti-inflammatory effects, microcirculation activation. There's analgesic effects, reduction of pain. As they mentioned, possibly due to endorphin release. Immunostimulation with, you know, correction of cellular humoral. Humoral is a liquid, you know, liquid environment where the immune cells thrive in. Increase in antioxidant activity. The blood, stabilizing lipid peroxidation in cell membranes, so you're balancing the fat level. Stimulation of, you know, this is a word for cell, red blood cell production, vasodilatation, which is relaxing the blood vessels, normalizing of acid-base balance. We, you know, a lot of us, you know, want to try to achieve more acidic, you know, so alkaline levels in the system. Reflects or genetic effects of the organs, which is the start of the reflexes in these systems. There is indication that it has a role in recovery after trauma or surgery. From observations, it really does that. It actually accelerates from recovery from surgery, even cancer therapy. Treatment of hyperlipidemia, when diet and, you know, your diet and taking of drugs has not been effective. Strengthening the immune system, this is one area that I find that's pretty, pretty clear from observations. So, Professor Liu mentioned, based on research and other researchers in China, he said, based on my years of research in natural medicine, the easiest non-invasive way, and they've been researching intravenous blood irradiation too, to achieve homeostasis is through intranasal photobiomodulation. And why? So anatomically, you can explain it this way, you know, with the concentration of blood vessels. There are many very small blood vessel capillaries. They're mainly concentrated near the nasal area. So the light source is really very, you know, producing photons through these very reachable areas. So we get on to now the intranasal. This is an example which we produce. Lon, could you turn on this video too? Here you go. So we used to do this for fun, you know, when you take sample of red blood cells, you do a, you know, you put it in the under the microscope, you can observe changes before and after. And we've done more than 1,000 of these for fun, but we never did a serious statistical study to publish it. And people who are, you know, practitioners who practice live cell analysis in the various equipment and the license to extract blood can easily do this. So let's move on. Lon, can you remove this?
I have a question for you, Lew Lim, on that. Because that looks like the dark field microscope, right? Was that a live blood analysis? Is that what you were using there?
Yeah, we actually, you can do it with a fairly low-cost microscope, $300 at a time.
How long after the laser? Like, was it you took the blood right before, then you did the laser and looked at it right after, or was it after so many sessions?
So we used just one session. We did it before we put on the nasal applicator. You could use they are actually visible red, either the laser version or the LED non-laser version.
Okay.
After 25 minutes, one treatment, then we take a sample of the blood again and put it under the microscope, and this is what you found. And frankly, it's very easy to do. You can just do it for fun.
Well, we have the dark field in our clinic, so we're going to play with that on some of our, we're going to test it out. Thanks for sharing.
Sure. And if you do a, you know, thermal imaging on your hands, you can actually see the change as well. So it does affect the body systemically. Now I'd like to move into the brain. And this is where a lot of my, you know, my energy is being devoted right now. And this is a paper that I think you should just download. It's free access. So Mike Hamblin of Harvard did a pretty good high-level review. I think it was published last year, or 2016. So in summary, when you direct light, whether it's LED, the infrared, fairly high-powered red lasers, in human studies, you're getting, actually there's a clinical study done, a pretty big one of stroke, and there was, you know, case studies on traumatic brain injury. We're doing Alzheimer's, I'll touch a bit more later. evidence of, you know, some kind of recovery in a comatose situation. Papers published in for depression and anxiety. Animal studies done with Parkinson's. There's a group, the same group who I mentioned earlier in Australia, actually they've got the IRB funding to do a Parkinson's disease study. And animal studies covered multiple sclerosis. Now, you know, why, you know, how is it possible? And you can go back to cell level studies. So here's an example, and there were a few of cells that were put under oxidative stress, you know, and they, here are the before pictures where they've lost the dendrites from some of the neurites, and after a few days they recover again. So you can do that at the neurons at cell level, and there were animal studies published a few years ago. Just a few days ago, there was a big publicity about animal studies showing that if you can control BAC1, which is an enzyme that leads to, you know, the amyloid beta proteins, you can actually reverse Alzheimer's. But, you know, photobiomodulation testing on animals is done. This is a later study that was done. This one published in 2009. Demonstrating that before the biomodulation, we can actually reduce the biomarkers for Alzheimer's, the beta amyloid proteins, and also improvements in animal behavior. And of course, our research is done in some areas. This is one that was, this is a helmet. I make fun of that. That's Professor Margaret Nazer of Boston. So they got this before we produced a neuro. There are hundreds of LEDs in this helmet, literally producing, directing red LEDs into the brain and with our intranasal device. This is a study for Gulf War illness that's ongoing right now for a few years already. And it's going to be used for PTSD as well. And you can direct, you know, like to the brain in various ways. You can do, you know, a device like that, you plug to the wall, and you know, you have hundreds and hundreds of LEDs. But you need cooling fans to cool it if you do it this way. Or you can do it in a much more efficient way, just a few modules here. And this is the reason, this is, you know, is what the new neurons look like. And we are directing this to the various nodes of the default mode network. No need to go too deeply, but basically, you know, when I designed this, it was to address primarily Alzheimer's disease. And Alzheimer's has been, you know, highly correlated to the default mode network, the nodes there, the lesions are there. You direct it there, you are doing a couple of things apart from healing the neurons. You're also, activating the whole default mode network. And the default mode network is, you know, associated with Parkinson's, with chronic pain, with schizophrenia, a bunch of, you know, brain diseases. So it's a good reason to target these particular areas of the brain. Now, drugs have made many attempts. Those who have any interest in Alzheimer's research would know that drugs have failed. I think 96% of drugs have failed, you know, in clinical trials. These ones actually, going back quite a number of years, just help with the symptoms. They don't affect, it doesn't modify the disease. It doesn't modify the disease. And this was, I mean, was it 2015? You know, since then, nothing's been done. Recently, last year, there were some quite dramatic news about people abandoning studies. This year, now we're in February. Since January, Pfizer behind this popular drug before, Aricept have You know, now they're banning the whole research study on Alzheimer's. They're retrenching 800 people in that department. And you've got Exelend with announced failures. You've got the only hope left, Biogen, have said that they're going to modify the protocol because, you know, to improve the outcomes. So lots of stuff happening, but no real solution from the drug side. Now, so we published this more than a year ago. We did an early study, case report on a case series on 5 patients. All of them responded positively to our early version of the neuro and the 810 in intranasal device. Just to summarize, the outcomes are obviously significant, and they can be presented in a chart like this. So if you're familiar with measuring cognition, particularly for Alzheimer's disease, you would recognize MMSC and a change. This is measured against against baseline zero. So we see, you know, after 3 weeks, looking at, you know, pretty high level, you know, it peaks and it keeps, you know, the sample in, population improve up to 12 weeks. So 2.5 is huge because, you know, to find even to maintain a zero is a big story already. Now here's the interesting part, which teaches me that, you know, it's a degenerative disease. You got to keep treating it, or the genes, the power of the genes take over. So when we stopped at a control at 12 weeks, many of the patients declined significantly. It teaches a couple of things. One is the modality works, for this small sample, and you want to keep treating it. Lauren, can you put on the third video?
Life for me when...
So this was people that studied. Go ahead.
Lou, because the recording will overlap, so I'll let you set up the video and then we'll play it. So I'll let you describe it, and then once you're done describing it, we'll hit play.
Okay. So at the end of that study, we actually we had a celebration dinner. We actually recorded some of the participants. I'm not sure which video this is, but the caregivers or the patients are explaining their experience during the study. We wanted to put a face to those numbers, so you understand what they are going through. So we have quite a number of recordings, but I thought this was an interesting one. Are you ready?
He started. A treatment was very, very stressful. It was unbelievable. He used to wander. He would go through. He would go through cupboards. He would. It was just, and he would have temper tantrums, and it was very, very, very difficult. It was very stressful.
Yeah. That's it.
Yeah, it's better now, right? Yeah, it's better. Yeah, it's better. Yeah. Yeah. Much better, right?
Oh, much better. Yeah.
I couldn't tear up because it was so awful before.
It was so awful before.
I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
It seems with dementia, you don't... I guess you see everything, right?
Feel everything.
This study that we're involved in is a feasibility study, so it's relatively small, but it is a randomized controlled study.
With the treatment, I feel a lot brighter. Nothing's dull anymore. I can look around and nothing's dull.
It was a complete change. He became calm. He stopped wandering. He was able to sleep at night, and he stopped searching for everything.
Essentially, what we're doing is evaluating the patients at 3 points. Baseline, where are they before they start treatment? Halfway through treatment at 6 weeks, and then at completion of treatment at 12 weeks.
Is it possible that a small Canadian company has succeeded when all these multinational big pharma has failed?
So before I get, maybe I should do this. Okay. So we, excuse me. Now we use the, excuse me, let me use my throat. So we use the original neural and the A10 to produce those results. But we wanted to improve on the outcome. So MIT published a paper, I think at the end of 2016 as well, showing that they did a really good paper to show that when you pulse light at 40 hertz, just to put in summary, you can actually reduce the biomarkers for Alzheimer's in the brain in animals just within 7 days. So we developed a 40 hertz version, we call it gamma, and we quickly at random pull in Barry, you know, in this case, we actually presented this paper as well. And this is Barry after 3 weeks, but, you know, week one, he wasn't looking at us. Has, you know, his improvement generalized by the caregiver who's a trained therapist and also his sister. And I wanted to, there are 13 variables here. So we're looking about eye, we're looking at typical things to look out for in dementia, Alzheimer's, which is eye contact, demeanor, motor skill and writing, general motor skill, reading, email, the ability to write and read email, orientation, long-term, short-term memory, clarity of, you know, expression, critical and abstract thinking, you know, conversation, mood. So observe, you know, day one, they were actually pretty low. So we know because, you know, if you're experienced in treating Alzheimer's patients, these are the things that you'll notice. Eye contact is a big deal. You know, it is a way they function in a social environment as well. So very close to very little, zero. And 2 weeks, the improvement was pretty dramatic. 2 days, 7 days, you're looking at, you know, pretty significant change, and the caregiver phoned me and said, I'm having my brother back. And 21 weeks is where we stopped, you know, recording, but a lot of these numbers, we're talking about, you know, measurement of 0 to 10, so they're pretty close to normal. And so you've met Barry at that stage, you wouldn't think he had anything wrong with him. So I can't say that this one case represents the whole population. Put on a, you know, a neuro gamma is gonna observe, experience the same thing. We don't know. So we have to do a much bigger study. Someone said this is, you know, could be beginner's luck. Okay. So we're doing a much bigger clinical trial right now. It's registered. We're in the process of being registered, and we'll see what happens. So there are skeptics, you know, not a lot of people, unlike more and not a lot of people have heard of photobiomodulation. It's new, it's not like transcranial directing electricity to the brain, although they don't work that well, but it has been researched for many years in the mainstream. So the question is, can such low power light energy penetrated to the brain, and will the brain respond? And I guess one way to answer it is to see how the brain responds. Look at the electrical signals. And so we got really serious into investigating with EEG, which is really measuring the level of, you know, the electrical signals, basically is electrophysiology. So we did a live demo in a conference just to demonstrate real time if the brain responds.
Are you on?
Ready?
Okay, not yet.
Okay, not yet.
Good. So let's take a look at Jack. Seeing him without the stimulation. And now what we want to do is turn the stimulation on and see what we get. Yeah. It's both. Could you get that just from nasal? Yes.
We got it. Get that just from nasal. Yes.
I bet. That seems to be, like my professor said, a testable hypothesis. And given what I saw with the graduate students, you know, and they were just using the V-light.
Can you describe what we were seeing there with that image that was red and green of the brain, what they were showing us?
So this was using the Brain Master software, is very popular with a lot of neurofeedback practitioners. Those who do it will, you know, recognize it. Basically, the brain is normal, just functioning as normal, unstimulated, you'll green, you know, and when you produce a stimulation, it turns red. So we adjusted the response in the software to show that. So what you saw was green, and when we turn it on, in real time, it turned red, and when you turn it off, it went back to green. So that was a real-time response. And I think some of the neurofeedback practitioners are, you know, just doing this for fun as well now. So that is a, you know, a way to show that the brain does respond. Now, I want to touch this quickly. We want to know what happens now to normal brains. And this was, the principal investigator is from the University of Toronto. He's one of the top EEG experts in the country. So he did, this is a study on 20 normal brains. You know, busy rest, you treat it with a gamma for 20 minutes, rest again. And for 20 patients, and this is randomized double-blind study, by the way. So this is really interesting. It's never been observed anywhere in the field of non-invasive brain stimulation.
Lou, do you want to explain a little bit gamma, just the wavelength, why that's significant, gamma?
Okay. So gamma pulses at 40 hertz. I had explained that we had used this to treat Alzheimer's disease because it was, it was activating the microglia to clear the amyloid beta biomarkers in the brain. Now, so I wasn't going to go into this. Now, Alzheimer's patients, Parkinson's patients, and you know, people with some neurodegenerative disorder show low level gamma. Autistic kids also show low level gamma. People with attention deficit disorder show low level gamma. High level, low frequency, so they're kind of locked in. But if you can have something that actually raise the level of these higher frequency oscillations. So we are talking about gamma, which is basically you're talking about like 35, 30 or so to whatever, high frequency, high activation. That's gamma. You go a bit slower, that's beta. You know, beta is like 12 to 20 or 20 to 30. And then you're talking about then the alpha, 8 to 12, then you have even slower ones like theta when you are really into like, you know, getting to sleep. And you're in a deep sleep, you're in delta. So, so what this demonstrates is in a randomized double-blind study, it's significantly in each time in one session increases the level of high oscillations in the brain and downregulate the slow oscillations. And what this means is at gamma level, when you're alert, when you're, you know, in a high level of self-awareness of what's going on, you know, that is, you know, you're into gamma. So you want to be in that state. When you're learning or studying, you're trying to work out solutions, you're in beta. So you're in beta, which, you know, and beta is where you're using your cognition in processing it, you know, the soft problems. And you want to be at SA, but not so much of this because, you know, you can get overexcitation and so on. But when it's needed, you want to be in this state. But gamma is also very interesting. I'll cover that a bit later. In meditation, high-level meditators will have this persistent high gamma, which is really, really interesting. So that is the effect when you can direct near infrared light at this high oscillation levels. And so this is a summary of what we found, and the paper has been written up now for publication. So we get brain response and treatment is quick and significant, invoking gamma, elevates fast brain waves. This is the other thing is if you're into brain rehabilitation, you want to have a good effect of the GABA. It's a neurotransmitter that that produces some inhibition in the brain, which leads to some a recovery of order and balance of homeostasis in the brain. And this implies that we can actually hack the brain by controlling key parameters. Well, let's say we can enhance the functioning of the brain. And so we developed this. It's a prototype stage now. We're refining our research further. And what we've done, we added more modules here and here to the dorsal lateral prefrontal. We added one to the back, which is in the, to direct energy to the midbrain and the cerebellum, which affects your reflexes and so on, the autonomic functions in the body. Now, so we are able now to control to a tablet, the oscillations, the frequency of pulsing in the light from zero, which is continuous, to up to 200 hertz. We didn't want to do 200, but we had requests from these researchers in meditation, brain performance, let's try up to 200, see what happens. So we are getting to research, but let's go back to some of the evidence that's already out there. And I mentioned about meditation. So this paper demonstrated that, yogis, dependent monks, who are at high level of meditation for many years, they have this persistent high level gamma. Now we tested on a couple of experienced meditators. We pulse at 10 hertz alpha to get into this calming state, the initial stage of meditation right away. But for these experienced meditators, when we use 40 hertz, they get into that high level state in 1 to 2 minutes, almost immediately. When it would have taken a long time, or they to take them in a a retreat in a resort where they do this meditation together after a few days. So that's very interesting. We're doing more research here, we hope to start this in April. They are playing around with this. They're telling us very interesting things. So I'm excited about this. Just not treating diseases, but see how we can enhance the performance of the brain. This is based on other studies. When you direct photobiomodulation to the brain, you actually improve reaction time and active. And when it's in control, it's not such a great reduction in the amount of reaction time. And here, treated in University of Texas, Austin, on college students. So they directed this light to the temple. And pre-treatment, these are controls. Of course, nothing much, but after one treatment, you can see the memory retrieval time, the latency has reduced significantly, and the accuracy of the information recall has gone up significantly as well. So that's all very interesting. So it shows that, you know, we can actually improve cognition in healthy brains. And so the same group, actually, in the same lab, same professor, they published this in 2016 to try to explain some of this, you know, and to look to measure the oxygenation in the brain. So what we're observing here is, you know, HBO2 is oxygenated blood. HB is deoxygenated blood. So as over treatment, you find that the amount of oxygenated blood in the brain, the areas where they're directing the light, has gone up. The deoxygenated blood present in the brain has reduced. In this particular chart, HBT is the total. So the total is interesting, remain the same, which means that, you know, explained by this, high oxygenated, reduced, deoxygenated. And this green line measures the difference. HDT is the difference between oxygenated blood and deoxygenated blood. Is very significant, whether you do it for you did the right prefrontal and the left prefrontal. So very interesting, you know, people have explained Alzheimer's, it could be possibly because of the reduced oxygen in the brain, reduced, you know, blood flow to the brain and so on. So that's one way to explain, but obviously most circulation is better. And this is the future as I see it, and we're deeply involved, and I think we're at the cutting edge of this. So you test hypotheses like the brain. You measure it through EEG, and you get all these signatures, and it helps us, you know, I'm hypothesizing that it is going to help us to explain why, for example, in Alzheimer's, some people are responding more quickly and some more slowly to the treatment. So we may be able to discover, you know, in this EEG signatures, why, you know, some people are having attention deficit disorder, and, you know, is it which part of the brain is being affected, which part of the brain is over talking, too much chatter in the brain, which part of the brain is not producing enough signals. So we're talking about say coherency, for example, in two parts of the brain that are too much locked in, you know, highly coherent, hypercoherency. So we can maybe break it up, you know, by, you know, the computer sending signals to, say, the equipment to send asynchronous, or, you know, signals that are out of phase between these two and break up the chatter. And I've tested this hypothesis with some of the leading people in this research, and they agree that, you know, is, you know, hypothetically it could work. So we're going to do more research in that and produce, you know, get more database and be able to do this brain computer interface technology better and see what happens in the future. Perhaps one day a lot of this can be automated. So that's the end of my presentation. Thank you for
thank you very much, Lew Lim. And I wanted to just a couple questions around the mechanisms. One is, there was a question about RLS reactive oxygen species. And a lot of people think of that as a bad thing. And you were mentioning here that this is a good thing with the laser. And you earlier talked about homeostasis. So there's this idea, too little is too little and too much is too much, which I think is what we have here with RLS. But could you go a little bit into that and maybe connect it to the nitric oxide and the benefits based on the laser mechanism?
Yeah. So RLS is a free radical. And actually, at low level, it is, you know, it synthesizes the signaling molecule that lead to gene transcription, and it leads to, you know, molecules like NF kappa B, which, you know, which explains cellular recovery and so on. which is so that is at low level. At high level, obviously, is not good. Now that's why in the field of photobiomodulation, there is an understanding that there is a biphasic response. Too little does nothing. You have a sweet spot that does a lot of good things. Too much actually is not a good thing either. You can lead to setbacks and actually more problems. So there is a biphasic response, and I think this question is valid because it could be overproduction of ROS, which is not a good thing. But the cells always try to establish homeostasis, but if too much of it can get to a point where it's overwhelmed the cell. That's why I don't believe in high power laser, because let's say, I know there's a group that's published, you say it helps traumatic brain injury and so on. But really, high power, you talk about 10 watts, 15 watts, to me it's pretty crazy. You can actually toast the skull of your brain if you don't move around quickly. So you don't have to be that impatient. Just, let the body take its time to spread this, the photons throughout.
So let me just clarify for the group, because we're talking about power. So if you get over 500 milliwatts of power, a half a watt, if you're over that, you're into class 4. And then kind of under 500 to, I don't know how low it goes, I can't remember, but you're kind of in a class 3B. So in your systems, what's the power that you're using that you've been doing for Alzheimer's that you're kind of recommending on the brain? And do you think there's a certain level people shouldn't be using it over a certain power that you recommend? Because there are people that are going to see PBM or LLT and they just think, oh, everything's good and I can put it on the head. But you've just said too much power is not a good thing in your opinion. And so can you just clarify kind of what power you've been using and what you're recommending?
Okay, first of all, we don't use lasers for safety reasons. And I want to get this out into the public as soon as possible. Lasers are going to hit hurdles and barriers with FDA and so on, because you really have to test for safety. So why do we need laser when the science is, as long as you deliver these photons to the mitochondria, it doesn't matter whether it's coherent like a laser. It's
so
not
I'll just pause again, because a lot of people are quite new. So what Lew is talking about is when you have coherent light, that's laser. Think of a laser. And then when you use an LED incoherent, it's like kind of scatters a bit. And what the research has shown, there is some research on this, that it doesn't matter so much the source, whether it's LED or a laser source. What matters is the wavelength of the laser, the light. And so what kind of light are you using? Red, near infrared, what's the wavelength? And that's more important than what's delivering that light source. That's my reading. Lew, you're much more into this experience than I am, but that's what I've interpreted from the research I've read.
You're absolutely correct. Now, you asked about the power. So we're talking about milliwatts here. So people might say, hey, milliwatts, so it wouldn't penetrate. But, I've demonstrated, even though we use low power, the brain responds. We measure it with EEG. We measure it with our clinical outcomes. So that, people use high power because they do research with data, with cadavers. So you use a dead, a sheep head, which has been, all dead tissue. There's no signaling going on. So there's a lot of signaling going on that carries this efficacy of this red or near infrared light. There is, there's the, this guy talking about these appearing energy signaling. There is the stem cell that some of these explanations published. In the blood, there is, the platelets is a rich mitochondria. So various explanations can come about. I guess more work has to go into to crystallize exactly what is going on. And I would propose too that, there's some quantum mechanics going on. It's hard to research in quantum mechanics, but the researchers at photosynthesis have explained it pretty well. Photosynthesis involves plants and bacteria. Bacteria and the mitochondria is a form of bacteria. Although there's no chromophore, the green chlorophyll. But there is you know, it opens the research to give a better explanation. So power, you know, for the neurons, I put an upper limit of 100 milliwatts on the top of the head. The nasal is 25, the one at the front is 75 milliwatts per square centimeter. Why 100? When you go out to the open, you know, the sun, the exposure is basically, it's come to 100 milliwatts. So we've been, evolved and you know, come this way to be able to handle, to tolerate that amount of energy. So I don't want to go further than that as long as we get good clinical outcomes. That is, that's how the parameters, everything is thought of other than pulse, so even the power. So that's another question.
Another question, you're talking about the ROS, the reactive oxidative species, and again, a little bit is good. You mentioned the gene transcription, and too much isn't good. So if you're doing something like treating Alzheimer's where they're getting regular treatment, is it the frequency of treatment and not the frequency as in the light flashing, but how often you're treating somebody? Can if somebody's coming doing the laser treatment, they have this device at home that you have, and they're doing this every day or every other day over a long period of time, could we increase the ROS so it has a negative impact? Or is it more in one treatment, bombarding the cells with the photons, so having too much power or just too much treatment and too much light in one treatment that causes the problem? Do you understand my question, the difference between one treatment versus doing it over a long period of time?
So the general recommendation when you use the neuro, to me, is already pretty powerful. We have observed some side effects before, so we try to control it. Some people are sensitive. So most people don't feel, but some people feel heat. I've used it, I've tested it, I don't feel anything. But some people do, so they are sensitive. We got to be aware of this, what's going on here. So we recommend once every 2 days. In fact, if you look at a lot of these clinical studies, they have been, they've been treated once every 2 days, twice a week, three times a week, and it produces results. So for a normal healthy brain, I'll say once every 2 days with the neurons is enough. The less powerful devices like the intranasal only, even up to 8-10, you can use up to twice a day because they're pretty low level, and we've observed not hardly any side effect there. Now, for people with degenerative disease like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, they're going downhill. By the time you are diagnosed with these diseases, you already have atrophy in the brain and a lot of dead brain cells already, and you're not so sensitive, but we want to deliver enough to get more immune response from these brains. So we recommend once a day, but we also always recommend take a day off, because it's like doing exercises. You keep doing it, your body is going to feel the fatigue, and you need your body to recover and be able to take on next level. So we always recommend a break, and this is found to be pretty useful. So actually, this is the protocol for clinical trial, our pivotal study for Alzheimer's disease: once a day, 6 days a week, 1 day off, treat again, they're for home use. And I also recommend that they do it while they're sleeping or taking a nap if possible. Why do we do that? So I mentioned, if you recall, I mentioned briefly, when we pulse at 40 hertz, we actually modify the microglia. The microglia in the brain's dysfunction is to clear this debris in the brain. These plaques that you don't need, the toxins, when there's always this debris and toxins in the brain, the microglia is processing all the time. But they are probably more active, or even not more active when you're sleeping. The other thing that happens when you're sleeping is, it's only a few years ago that we have discovered that there is this lymphatic system. We call it lymphatic because it involves the clear cells and the lymphatic to clear all these toxins and unwanted debris and byproducts in the brain, and they are active when you're sleeping. So it is, you know, working with a microglia to do this. So I recommend, if possible, when you're sleeping or taking a nap. But for most people, the healthy brain, you do it anytime because we're not working on clearing, you know, this stuff in the brain. We're working on getting the brain up to the next level or healing depression or, you know, some of the other things where it doesn't really involve a lot of this, protein deposits, as you call it.
Last question for you, then we got to wrap up. Now, in my clinical experience and looking at the research, when we treat things like, you know, skin wounds or pain, you know, traumatic injury and repetitive strain disorders, you do a laser over a period of time and there's recovery and they're better. And they, when you stop the laser, they don't go backwards. I haven't done work with the brains at the level that you are working at, but I look at some of the research and it seems like that for a condition like Alzheimer's, that they see the improvement when they're on the late, when they're doing it regularly, but if they stop doing it, they will revert back. And has that been in your experience? And it's just important for managing patients' expectations, because for some conditions like Alzheimer's, where there really isn't a good treatment out there right now in conventional medicine, if somebody has to do laser three times a week for the rest of their lives and they can have a normal functioning life, I think it's a very awesome treatment. I just want to know, because in clinic, pain and injuries, those kind of things, they have that recovery and it doesn't usually revert back. But the literature seems to suggest that with Alzheimer's, dementia, they can revert back. This is your field. So has that been your experience?
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, you know, that's why, you know, we want to make these devices home use, portable, wearable. So you don't have to keep going to a clinic for the rest of your life. It's probably not feasible. It's probably very expensive. So this is a one-time investment, you know, for the rest of your life. And for Alzheimer's and dementia, you know, for late onset, you know, for example, the genes actually is what is a major factor for the disease you get. So people have a copy of, you know, this is an APOE gene. So a copy of some race, have two copies at higher rates, so like 60%. It sometimes, it often takes a trigger. It could be a concussion. It could be, you know, toxins that get in your brain. It could be infection. It could be a bunch of things that often trigger this. And then you get an onset of Alzheimer's. And you got to bear in mind, and this is where we published, I actually mentioned it in my presentation, when we stopped the, you know, the decline resumed quite aggressively too, to kind of catch up, you know. So the genes are, you know, this is all determined by, you know, a lot of it by the genes. So when you're treating the brain, it is actually fighting the, the effect of the genes. And for, you mentioned about traumatic brain injury, even stroke. There is studies done at Boston. They published these case reports where the recovery is actually quite impressive, significant. Many have recovered to gone back to where they were before. And for some of them, when they stopped, it didn't happen immediately like Alzheimer's, but over a few weeks or a few months, they see some regression. So something happened, something has changed when they have, you know, when they had this insult. And so it's good to have continuous treatment. And again, I stress the importance of home use because, look, when you're using it, there's no side effect. If anything, like I've mentioned, it enhances the performance of the brain. Why even stop, right? Just make it a daily routine. It keeps you sharp. I've got reports of people doing IQ tests and they've actually gone up. So it is,
Right.
So just keep using it.
I'll share how we're doing it here at AccuBounce in Vancouver, because it does seem with the brain, it's a special thing. And it seems like they do need continuous. So what we're doing is we're basically having them come in for about a month where we do our aggressive treatment, as in coming in quite regularly. And if they notice and see improvement, then they're encouraged to buy their own set. And that way they don't have to buy the set if they haven't seen improvement. And if they're not seeing improvement, then maybe they're one of those people that just aren't going to benefit. And so that's kind of what we're doing at our clinic, is do it for a month. And if you see the benefit, then buy your own, because it's a lot more affordable if you just buy it and have it versus coming to see me for the rest of your life. So that's what we're doing. That's how we recommend it at our clinic. So for those that are listening, that may work for you as well.
They're practicing it this way, because when they come to the clinic, you understand your client better, and you know, and see what other modalities working. Especially if you're doing EEG at the same time, you can observe, you can actually observe the measurements in the brain. Yeah, actually, we have a number of acupuncturists that does that for the first, I think up to 6 weeks, you know. And then after that, for them to continue to maintain the improvement.
I'll tell you a funny story, because people can see this with their patients. When I started playing with the laser on my head, the first couple of times, Lou, that I did this, I was exhausted after, and I didn't correlate it right away. I thought the first time I did it that I had the flu. It was, you know, that fatigue that comes on, like if you're a jet lag. It was just like unbearable fatigue where I was shutting down. And it wasn't until later that I had learned that those with brain injuries, like healthy brains, no issues, but a brain injury, sometimes they feel quite exhausted after laser. And so that's how I kind of diagnosed myself. All those little headbangs that I had as a kid playing football and hockey, I guess I had a little bit of an injury there. The interesting thing is I've continued to do it, and now I don't get fatigued from it at all. I feel calm, maybe a little up a bit, and again, the focus, especially the next day, the focus. So we call it the brain boost at our clinic. You know, if you want to really focus, and I lecture around the world, and I don't carry a laser with me, but if somebody has a laser, I'll go and ask if I can borrow it, or LEDs, and do some treatment. So I don't know, again, for the last question here with that story, is that, because that was my experience, and I saw in the literature, but some people with these brain injuries will feel quite fatigued at the beginning of using the light therapy, the photobiomodulation. Is that some of the patients experience that?
Yeah. Actually, we have different kinds of response. Actually, having a response is good, because doing something to your brain. And another story, kind of similar to yours. There was this, someone is really a leader in homeopathy, and he said, okay, he got one of our devices, and he came back the next day and reported, you know what, I had this headache, and you know, he's doing something to me. And I said, uh-oh. So you got to tell other people. He said, no, he said, that's a good thing, because, you know, because it's doing something. And I know my brain understand my body, and it is detoxifying, you know, the brain. So the next few days is better, and he likes it. So then example, and I had the example of, so it is using the 810 passing attendance of the alpha. And
I'm still here. Can you see me?
Anyone? Okay, right. Something froze temporarily. Okay, as long as you hear me, because I don't see myself moving. I remember the very first time we came out with the neuro, the original neuro. I knew this lady. She kept coming to me at shows, and she didn't want to try anything new, you know. She was trying all kinds of natural therapies, but you can tell there was a lot of problem the way she interacted. There was infection in the gums and so on, and she was confused. The first time she used that neuro, she cried. She said, I've never experienced anything like this. You know, my brain is cleared. The fogginess is cleared. I understand what's going on. The environment. So I thought that was, you know, I had a prototype at the time. This goes back a number of years. It gave me a lot of motivation to quickly finish all my product and get it to the public. So, you know, we get different kind of response. And you get athletes using the gamma, and hockey player, professional hockey player, he's more alert. He's using the other intranasal devices, the red, for his training. His endurance and recovery is better, his performance is better in the ice, because swimmers are responding to it, long-distance runner. These are the visible red trajecting into your body.
Nice. We're here. We're going to wrap up. We went a little over today, but, this is a field that I'm so interested in. We're using lasers and AcuBalance, treating pain and fertility and anxiety and boosting the brains. And we're really excited about helping people with Alzheimer's and dementia. So I'm so excited, Lew, that you shared the research that you're involved in. And again, to remind those, if you check V-Light, their website, and it's vlight.com, V-I-E-L-I-G-H-T.com, you can see the devices they have. And they were kind, again, I always ask when somebody is involved that they have a product, so he has a product, I always say, well, if you're going to be on our thing, maybe let the listeners have a deal. And they said, we can give 10% off. So if you use the coupon code Vancouver, they will take 10% off of your device. And then you can talk to them directly about getting some wholesale prices, et cetera, if you want to carry this in your clinic and sell it to your patients. But what a gift to be able to help people with dementia, Alzheimer's, and brain injuries. So this is a really good tool, especially for acupuncturists doing scalp acupuncture and acupuncture, to bring in the laser. In my clinic, it's been just so special, and it just works. It's a really integrative approach where we use it as laser acupuncture with our traditional acupuncture, and we've really benefited and liked it. So I'm glad you shared, and I hope to have more talks on photobiomodulation, low-level laser therapy for you guys to listen to. And I'm giving quite a few talks, the same talk, but a different length on using photobiomodulation for challenging fertility cases. So you can check out acubalance.ca for what we're doing, or check out healthyseminars.com, or email me directly if you want to know what city or country I'm presenting this lecture on. So, Lew, thank you very much. You guys, thanks for sticking around longer than an hour. And, again, I appreciate your time. Yeah.
Can I just add something? We actually have a pricing deal, a pricing structure for practitioners. So they are much more than 10%. Contact us either by email or give us a call at the toll-free number. Mention that you founded, this webinar. So we,
thanks.
Do that for you.
So thank that, you. That's great. All right. Have a good rest of your evening, and we'll be talking soon again. Because when I find somebody that's knowledgeable like you, I like to keep picking your brain so I can take some of that in. Now I'm going to go give myself a laser brain boost so I can absorb more of what we just talked about. Bye, everybody. Thank you very much.